Welcome to Fact Heist, the Science Bong Hit channel. In today's episode, we will try to explain night terrors. Enjoy! Night terrors, or sleep terrors, or more rarely, agitated sleepwalking, or even more rarely, pavor nocturnus, are common terms for some disorders of arousals. In this case, those clinical phenomena are some sleep arousal disorders. During those episodes, someone, often children, will abruptly wake up from sleep, but while still been asleep, wait, what? As a matter of fact, the body wakes up while the brain stays asleep, sometimes followed by a loud piercing scream or cry for help. In a state of overwhelming anxiety or acute panic, along with behavioral manifestation of intense fright, like distorted facial expressions of fear, agitated motor activity, shouting, flailing of the limbs, hitting the walls and shit, or even running as if reacting to imminent danger. Actually, sleep terrors can end or happen during a sleepwalking episode. But the sleepwalking associated with sleep terrors is obviously more frantic and vigorous than your average somnambulism. There is relative unresponsiveness or inconsolability to efforts of caregivers, parents, or anyone else to comfort the individual during the episodes. Those quality times can last from 1 to 10 minutes, but unfortunately, they may last way longer on night terror's primary targets, children. Although those terrifying episodes might look scary as shit, they are not, in kids, a sign of anything more serious, like no cause for medical concern, and they tend to end as abruptly as they started, as the person may simply awaken or return to bed without being completely awakened, like, without any recollection of some kind of the events. Night terrors are estimated to affect around 40% of children, but a way smaller number of adults. Night terrors are some kind of parasomnia, aka any weird shit going on, but sleep-related. Night terrors are also strongly associated with another parasomnia, sleepwalking, which happens during the same sleep stage. But most of all, night terrors differ from nightmares. Nightmares are bad dreams, and night terrors are not technically dreams. Instead, they're some kind of sudden fearful reactions that can occur during transitions from one sleep phase to another. And in your average nightmare, the dreamer can wake up and recall the bad dream, but during night terrors, the individual will usually stay in a sleep state. This main difference is most likely due to the very phase of sleep in which shit happens. So first, let's get to the basics, let's get into the different stages of sleep, for later understanding purpose. Sleep can be divided into 5 stages. The first one is when you are totally awake and fully aware, which isn't a sleep state at all, so I guess there's actually only 4 stages of sleep then. The real first stage is when you feel sleepy and slowly drifting into sleep, your heartbeat and breathing slow down, your muscles begin to relax. You are now getting sleepy, and sleepy, and sleepy. This falling asleep stage, also referred as N1, lasts a few minutes. The second stage, aka N2, is the light sleep stage, where your heartbeat and breathing slow down even further, your body temperature drops, and there's no eye movement. This part will last for around 25 minutes or some shit. N3, is the third and deepest sleep stage, your heartbeat and breathing are at their lowest rate, your body is totally relaxed, still no eye movements, but this is also the stage where your immune system strengthens, along with tissue repair and cell regeneration, the kind of stage in which you produce a lot of Z's. Then comes the last stage, not N4, but REM stage, the primary dreaming stage, therefore brain activity increases. Your heartbeat and your breathing rate increase. Your limb muscles becomes temporarily paralyzed, a condition known as sleep atonia, so you don't act out your dreams. But most of all, there's an increase in rapid eye movement, hence the name, REM sleep. You're welcome. FYI, the N in N1, N2 and N3 sleep stages stands for non, REM sleep. So now you know about the different sleep stages, but if you want to learn more about sleep, check our episode on some other sketchy sleep disorder, link up there. These stages of sleep are indeed crucial for the understanding of the disparity between night terrors and nightmares. Nightmare happen during the last stage, rapid eye movement, because guess what, nightmares are dreams, so they are produced during the dream-producing stage, REM sleep. While night terrors, on the other hand, happen during non-rapid eye movement sleep, in deeper sleep, when your muscles are not yet paralyzed. Moreover, nightmares often don't involve vocalization or agitation, or at least, way way less than night terrors. And someone experiencing a nightmare can easily wake up, like completely, and have HD crystal clear detailed memory of their bad dreams.
Don't be afraid. Bad dreams are only dreams.
According to the almighty DSM-5, The symptoms of night terrors may start by screaming, shouting, or crying. Then sit up in bed and look scared, like with eyes wide open, like with dilated pupils and shit.
There's some seriously weird shit going on with your eyes.
Along with racing pulse, heavy breathing, a flushed face, and sometimes getting soaking wet from sweat, the person may get out of bed and run around the house, and can also thrash and kick things, while still being hard to wake up nonetheless, and can have some aggressive behavior when blocked or held back, so beware. But if safely awakened, the person might be confused and impossible to be comforted or soothed. And despite all this, the person or child, because children are not persons, will have no memory or recollection whatsoever of the event later on. But to be diagnosed with night terrors, this BDSM-5 book has specific criteria: the obvious screams, sudden arousal from sleep, then distress and unresponsiveness during the episode. But these episodes have to be recurrent, with some autonomic symptoms like tachycardia. And when fully awake, there's a complete amnesia of the event. Those terrors cannot be explained by any other underlying condition, but can cause significant distress in everyday's life, or at work or school or with social interaction. But who cares about social interactions? Of course, these symptoms may vary from person to person. For example, adults are more likely to remember highly detailed images associated with sleep terrors compared to young children, who could only vaguely recall at best. This lower subjective recall rate in kids than in adults may reflect the obvious differences in brain physiology and development. Also, adults are way more likely to wake up right after an episode, while the experience is still fresh. Night terrors in young Homo sapiens are more likely to occur in males than females, but for the 1-2% of adults population experiencing the condition, the ratio between sex is equal. But it remains unusual, and more often results from a history of stress, anxiety, post-traumatic disorder, schizophrenia, depression, or just poor sleep hygiene. Because any of these adult stuff disorders increase the risk of experiencing sleep terrors or any other parasomnias. So as night terrors, in adults, can be symptomatic of an underlying psycho or neurological disease, then I guess it should be further investigated through an fMRI procedure or some shit. However, being an adult and experiencing sleep terrors is never ever an indication by itself of an underlying psychiatric or neurologic condition. There's no strong association, because most of the time, there's not even any single biochemical or structural abnormality found in the brain. So mellow the fuck out. As adults may be more likely to remind an episode, scientists ask some of them, like, what is it like? So basically some subjective self-reporting, but, despite the fact that there was no really real reality testing, half of them nonetheless mentioned that some mental content was present, like some clear and vivid hallucinatory experiences of characters or objects projected like inside their real home environment. Some of them adults also reported some kind of self-perspective during the episode, and any of their dynamic actions was often acted out of apprehension and in response to some danger type of shit, while still in a home setting environment. Those subjective depiction of mental contents, provided by adult patients, and their sketchy behaviors, as described by witnesses, both suggest a complex interaction between externally and internally generated perceptive stimuli. And because this does not happen during a dreamlike state, this phenomenon is rather more evocative of a hallucinatory, psychotic-like mental state. But once again, researches on this very topic hasn't shown any strong association between night terrors and some psychiatric conditions. So let's take a one-way ticket to the head piece to try to understand WTF is going on a more brain-centric point of view, assuming that it happens most definitely in children, the stage of brain development, and therefore, the maturation stage of neuronal activity need to be considered. But researches show that it may be mainly due to some dysregulations and disruptions in the finely orchestrated activation and deactivation of local processes during sleep. And indeed, dysfunctional and independent actions of wakefulness and non-rapid eye movement sleep systems are thought to be at the basis of those arousal parasomnias thing. These clinical features of confusional arousals are effectively consistent with some dysfunctional coexistence between localized cortical sleep and localized cortical arousal.
Woo! Alright!
For instance, there's persistence of some sleep state in the hippocampus, the memory factory of the brain, so you can probably draw a link between this and the post-episode amnesia. Likewise, there's some similar sleep state in frontal associative cortices, the main thinking parts of the brain. While, in contrast, the strongly negative emotions of an episode suggest that there's some awakening of the emotional network, and especially the amygdala, along with arousals in the insular, cingulate and motor cortices, the amygdala being the headquarters of fear and aggression, whereas the insular cortex is a multimodal sensory processing brain area processing the process of interoceptive awareness. I mean, like, it is in charge of providing sensory information about the internal state of the body. The insular cortex's functions also include self-awareness, and the sense of body ownership, interpersonal experiences, motor control, and a number of basic emotions, especially fear and anger. The insular cortex has also been identified as some kind of central command center that ensure blood pressure and heart rate when shit needs to get physical. This insular cortex thing plays a role in these many functions, among many other things I won't list, because I told you, it's a multimodal sensory processing brain area, didn't you listen for fuck's sake?
Whatever, yeah.
In addition, the anterior part of the insular cortex projects to the amygdala, I mean it, connects to the amygdala, the fear and aggression center of the brain from earlier. Please at least tell me you remember this one. So if I had to sum this up, the frontoparietal parts of the brain, which control executive functioning, like decision-making, reasoning and memory are sleeping, while some of the motor and main emotional freakout centers of the brain are turned up to 11. And at the same time, there's an unusual activation of the fight or flight response, the physiological reaction to stress, danger or any perceived harmful event, hence the heart rate and muscle tone increase. And don't forget the terrified, distorted look on the face, for good measure. In general, night terrors afflicted toddlers are more likely to have fragmented sleep, but it's not crystal clear if this sleep fragmentation triggers sleep terrors, or if sleep terrors lead to fragmented sleep. And these results, on the average, represent some early sign of emotional behavioral problems in non-adults toddlers. Sleep terrors are associated with the most violent emotional state in the sleep game. And while they start from a sudden arousal from the deepest stage of non-REM sleep, they often continue into some kind of sustained hallucination, of somehow being attacked. And then the scream of terror and motor escape from the imaginary monster or attacker or whatever, is shortly preceded, like in a heartbeat, by autonomic arousal, this fight or flight thing. And the cause for this is thought to be the loss of regular parasympathetic inhibition functions of the sympathetic nervous system, aka a major glitch in the on-off switch of the fight or flight response system during sleep. Nightmares' emotions, by contrast, are way less intense and tend not to produce an autonomic response, because it is assumed that the inhibitory afferent-efferent processes, meaning some back-and-forth neuronal wiring system, that goes from the brain to wherever there's something to inhibit, and then back again, for example during sleep atonia, when you are paralyzed, this system is thought to extend to the stress-related autonomic system during the REM sleep state and then you don't lose your shit that much when you dream. In opposition to night terrors, where there's an arousal in motor cortices and abnormal processing of emotion triggered by some hallucinatory scary character or any other frightening image, and only while during non-REM sleep, when the brain is then less active. In night terrors, there can be some single sketchy scary image of some sort, which could be the proximal trigger for a sleep terror episode. But, there is not, however, the kind of narrative story you can experience with nightmare or dreams. For the few unlucky adults experiencing this shit show, several factors can contribute to one or more episode of sleep terrors, like physical or emotional stress, fever light or noise, sleep deprivation, spending the night somewhere unfamiliar, an overfull bladder. So probably having an overfull bladder while sleeping somewhere unfamiliar, and obviously the use and abuse of alcohol and or drugs and or medication, I know you know what I mean. And all of these causes can vary depending, of course, of genetic factors, because kids or adults afflicted with this pain in the ass often have a family member already suffering from night terror or sleepwalking. I mean like 96% of the time. No shit. Some studies, link in the description below, and investigations on identical and non-identical twins heavily support and back up this findings. Some other study, and some other link in the description below. So this one long-term study was done on 1,940 children, and found that, those who had sleepwalking parents are more likely to experience night terrors, which will then persist for longer. So there's indeed some strong genetic heritability and persistence of sleep terror symptoms. Although sleep terrors episodes are obviously extremely distressing for children, there's usually no medication needed, because permanent harm is unlikely to happen, they can pass without intervention, and the kids often outgrow them night terrors. So no biggie, but there are some do's and don'ts. I mean, like you can hold this thing's hand and try to reassure it by speaking like calmly or something in order to shorten the episode. I guess this tip is useful if you like to wake up in the middle of the night. But I think it's better to prevent shit from happening. You can instead put the kids in a safer sleeping environment, or identify any potential sources of stress and remove them if possible. Try to deal with a child's stress. I mean, you can bring it to a counseling type of thing, or you can also bring your kids to the rapists. No, I mean therapists. Yeah, pedo jokes. You can't go wrong with pedophile jokes, instant icebreakers and crowd pleasers.
Oh, wow!
Still, to prevent your child from experiencing such turmoil, some other easy ways are available. Some simple shit. Simple interventions, like keep a good sleep schedule. Like having a relaxing sleep routine.
Oh my god, the responsibility of a human life.
Try to avoid sleep deprivation, obviously. Try to put it to bed earlier. And remember, don't feed it after midnight.
Night-night, sleep tight. Don't let the bed bugs... Oh. dead.
And if you are into these things, you can keep a sleep diary, observe and stay with the child.
Watch him sleep and rub this knife across my face while I do it.
Oh.
Note how and when night terrors happen. Look for patterns, and then wake your child 15 minutes before it has an episode and then try to keep it awake for 5 minutes and then put it back to sleep. Try to identify any source of stress. As sleep deprivation could be a factor, try to give the kid an afternoon nap. Ask the child about what's bothering it. And try to talk it through. Aim for some daily routine, some night daily routine of some sort, like reading something before sleep. And obviously, avoid any screen time, obviously, I mean for at least an hour before bedtime. But foremost, as terrifying as night terrors may look like, don't panic and wake the child, don't shake it, don't shout at it, don't try to snap it out of the sleep terror, because waking a child during an episode might result in making the experience more agitating and way scarier for the kid. Just ensure that it is safe. Hold it gently and let it return to sleep once the episode is over. But you can still prevent the kid from collateral side effects, like being exposed to physical dangerous and harmful situations, like falling off stairs or leaving the house or something. I mean sleepwalking freak shit. So try also to secure the sleep environment. Remove trip hazards and fragile and dangerous objects. Close and lock windows and doors at night. Other solutions come to my mind. You can cuff the kid to a bedpost, or put it back inside its mom. Some other collateral damage can be family members of persons afflicted by night terrors.
I shall return. Do not attempt to stop me.
Told you, kids got demons. I don't do that.
Their relatives, even if not physically injured, can indeed suffer from psychological trauma related to the disturbing sight of the scary and violent behavior displayed during night terrors episodes. All of this may sound like fun and games, but in adults, who can better remember the scary images? This disorder may result in way funnier outcomes. May result in way more serious issues. Violent consequences. And studies show that sleep terrors violence happens to be a reaction to a dreamed or hallucinated frightening image that the adult can describe, afterward, suggesting that a complex mental activity somehow takes place. The unwanted aggressive behaviors occurring during such parasomnias are favored by the unrestrained influence of the bad amygdala, which is no longer kept in balance by proper executive functions of the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex, since this last one remains hypoactive, remember? Those violent sketchy outbursts in adults are triggered, 81% of the time, by noise, or touch, close proximity type of shit, or more broadly by some kind of sensory provocation. Probably because they're a thalamic dysfunction, a dysfunction in the thalamus, which is the relay station of the brain, it prioritizes which incoming stimulus is relevant and which one is not. If you should care more about the feeling of your shirt on your skin or the sensation of walking on a piece of glass. This mismatch in the importance of subjective experience and the resulting disruption of arousal levels, plays indeed a role in provoking night terrors. FYI. Studies on parasomnias use polysomnography, a multi-parameter sleep study, with all these tools and measurement contraptions and EEGs and shit. The incidence of night terrors in laboratory setting is often lower than in the patient's usual environment, obviously. And somehow, sleep terrors episodes can be induced precipitously in predisposed people by auditory stimulation during the proper sleep stage. Go figure. Now, before giving any funny, horrible examples of what sleep terrors can produce in adults, there's a caveat. I must ask you not to laugh at what's yet to come. Unlike me, or this would be a form of what psychologists refer as Schadenfreude. That's the satisfaction, or more broadly the experience of pleasure resulting from humiliation or failure or pain or any trouble of someone else. I was going to give a shitload of details about Schadenfreude, but I figured out it could be a full episode of its own. Let's just say for now that it is some primitive behavior. So without further ado, here are some true stories about batshit crazy things done by adults during night terrors, shit that really happened, so please remember, try not to laugh like a douche. Unlike me. Once upon a time, some girl saw some spiders in her sleep. So she started to spit on her bed to drown them. I can feel that you are not impressed yet. So what about this one? Some other girl felt she was going to get run over by a truck. To avoid the collision, she jumped out of bed and out of her mezzanine. True story. And as often, males are the worst, as violence enters the game. Check this one. Some dude had images of two Japanese soldiers chasing him and his wife in the jungle, so he kicked one soldier and strangled the other one, killing his wife by strangulation in real life instead. True story. Some other guy, once had vivid images of soldiers. I couldn't find out if they were Japanese, so they were here to attack his daughter or some shit, so he run out of the house, still sleeping, remember? he grabbed an axe, don't laugh remember, went back home, entered daughter's room and, quote marks, defended her, end of quote marks, by hitting her twice with the axe. Yes, she died in the process. One night, a different guy, dreamed that burglars broke into his house and were killing his family, grabbed his guns, so that probably took place in the US, and fired 10 shots, injuring his mother, and killing his brother and his dad, shit happens. And finally, some unlucky dude had sudden vision of some kind of a wild animal rising from the floor or something, then tried to defend his child by grabbing a weapon or some shit, and then smashed the beast with it, like many times for good measure. But actually, I mean in real life, the beast was a wall and the weapon was his son, who died. True story. Don't believe me? Links in the description below. Considering that all of that happened in some altered non-conscious state type of shit, all of them people were acquitted, because none of them made use of free will, which is an illusion in the first place anyway.
Do I have free will?
Who does? Who does?
Hey!
But what are the treatment available for people afflicted by such a curse? You'll ask me. I mean, can you take a medication if you happen to be one of these few doomed people, in order to, I don't know, protect your family, for example? According to a trusted source, as it is sometimes specified in papers, benzodiazepines such as diazepam are considered the best and go-to drug because it has few side effects, and as levels of serotonin and its precursor can be linked to sleep terrors, SSRIs, aka selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors can be prescribed. The reuptake is the process in which some neurotransmitter comes back to its home sweet home neuron after use. So a reuptake inhibitor is something that blocks this process. You're welcome. So as a conclusion, if you are an adult, you suffer from night terrors, and you don't want to murder your family, take those pills. And, that's it for this episode of Fact Heist. I hope I have been useful and relevant.
You are a waste of life, and you should give up.
Don't forget to like and subscribe. See ya. Peace, peace.
Would you like for me to talk dirty to you?